Chapter 2, Part 3 of The Princess Aline by Richard Harding Davis. For reasons possibly best understood by the German ambassador, the state of the Hohenwalds at Constantinople differed greatly from that which had obtained at the French capital. They no longer came and went as they wished, or wandered through the show-places of the city like ordinary tourists. There was, on the contrary, not only a change in their manner towards others, but there was an insistence on their part of a difference in the attitude of others towards themselves. This showed itself in the reserving of the half of the hotel for their use, and in the haughty bearing of the equerries, who appeared unexpectedly in magnificent uniforms. The visitor's book was covered with the autographs of all of the important people in the Turkish capital, and the Sultan's carriages stood constantly before the door of the hotel, awaiting their pleasure, until they became as familiar a sight as the street dogs, or as cabs in a hansom cab rank. And in following out the programme which had been laid out for her, the Princess Aline became even less accessible to Carlton than before, and he grew desperate and despondent. "If the worst comes," he said to Miss Morris, "I shall tell Nolan to give an alarm of fire some night, and then I will run in and rescue her before they find out there is no fire. Or he might frighten the horses some day and give me a chance to stop them. We might even wait until we reach Greece and have her carried off by brigands who would only give her up to me." "There are no more brigands in Greece," said Miss Morris. "And besides, why do you suppose they would only give her up to you?" "Because they would be imitation brigands," said Carlton, "and would be paid to give her up to no one else." "Oh, you plan very well," scoffed Miss Morris, "but you don't do anything." Carlton was saved the necessity of doing anything that same morning when the English captain in attendance on the Duke sent his card to Carlton's room. He came, he explained, to present the prince's compliments, and would it be convenient for Mr. Carlton to meet the Duke that afternoon? Mr. Carlton suppressed an unseemly desire to shout, and said, after a moment's consideration, that it would. He then took the English captain down the stairs to the smoking-room, and rewarded him for his agreeable message. The Duke received Carlton in the afternoon, and greeted him most cordially, and with as much ease of manner as it was possible for a man to possess, who has never enjoyed the benefits of meeting other men on an equal footing. He expressed his pleasure in knowing an artist with whose work he was so familiar, and congratulated himself on the happy accident which had brought them both to the same hotel. "I may have more than a natural interest in meeting you," said the prince, "and for a reason which you may or may not know. I thought possibly you could help me somewhat. I have within the past few days come into the possession of two of your paintings. They are studies, rather, but to me they are even more desirable than the finished work, and I am not correct in saying that they have come to me exactly, but to my sister, the Princess Aline." Carlton could not withhold a certain start of surprise. He had not expected that his gift would so soon have arrived, but his face showed only polite attention. "The studies were delivered to us in London," continued the Duke. "They are of Ludwig the Tragedian and of the German Prime Minister, two most valuable works, and especially interesting to us. They came without any note or message which would inform us who had sent them, and when my people made inquiries, the dealer refused to tell them from whom they had come. He had been ordered to forward them to Grasse, but on learning of our presence in London, sent them direct to our hotel there. Of course it is embarrassing to have so valuable a present from an anonymous friend, especially so for my sister, to whom they were addressed, and I thought that, besides the pleasure of meeting one of whose genius I am so warm an admirer, I might also learn something which would enable me to discover who our friend may be. He paused, but as Carlton said nothing, continued. As it is now, I do not feel that I can accept the pictures, and yet I know no one to whom they can be returned unless I send them to the dealer. "It sounds very mysterious," said Carlton, smiling, "and I am afraid I cannot help you. What work I did in Germany was sold in Berlin before I left, and in a year may have changed hands several times. The studies of which you speak are unimportant and merely studies, and could pass from hand to hand without much record having been kept of them. But personally, I am not able to give you any information which would assist you in tracing them." "Yes," said the Duke. "Well, then, I shall keep them until I can learn more, and if we can learn nothing, I shall return them to the dealer." Carlton met Miss Morris that afternoon in a state of great excitement. "It's come!" he cried. "It's come! I am to meet her this week. I have met her brother, and he has asked me to dine with them on Thursday night. That's the day before they leave for Athens, and he particularly mentioned that his sister would be at the dinner, and that it would be a pleasure to present me. It seems that the eldest paints, and all of them love art for art's sake, as their father taught them to do, and for all we know, he may make me court painter, and I shall spend the rest of my life at Grasse painting portraits of the Princess Aline at the age of 22 and at all future ages, and if he does give me a commission to paint her, I can tell you now in confidence that that picture will require more sittings than any other picture ever painted by man. Her hair will have turned white by the time it is finished, and the gown she had started to pose in will have become 40 years behind the fashion." End of chapter 2, part 3.